بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، والصلاة والسلام على خير الخلق نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، إن شاء الله today we will study the last آيات of Surah Munafiqun. This Surah that is a Madani Surah that was revealed to expose the Munafiqeen. To expose the Munafiqeen during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and during any time. And it mentioned almost 10 qualities of the Munafiqeen. First of all, because as we said that the Surah started by them trying to testify in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that they believe in him. And we said that Allah Jalla wa Ala said that he knows that you are his prophet, but Allah Jalla wa Ala also testifies, and Allah Jalla wa Ala testifies that they are really liars. And we said that they are trying to testify that that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or that Muhammad is the prophet of Allah Jalla wa Ala, in order to what? In order to please him. Otherwise, if they really believe in him, they would say, by the way, we believe in Allah, we believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we believe in you. Not they just come to him saying that we believe in you. That's why Allah Jalla wa Ala said, إِذَا جَاءَكَ الْمُنَافِقُونَ قَالُوا نَشْهَدُ إِنَّكَ لَرَسُولُ اللَّهِ. We testify that you are the Prophet. They didn't say, we testify that Allah is the only Lord to be worshipped, because they are not interested in this. They are just interested in pleasing the Prophet for the matters of the dunya and covering their faith. That's why Allah Jalla wa Ala said, in fact, they have taken their oaths, any oaths that they mention, whether the oaths in front of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam or any oaths in general, they took it as a cover, as a shield, to conceal their hypocrisy. And we said that nifaq, we explained extensively what nifaq is and what is the reality, the psychological problem behind nifaq, that the person has a psychological problem that imitates from his kufr, from the disbelief that is in his heart, but he is coward enough not to have any kind of audacity, or he's not brave enough to say that he is a disbeliever. This is one thing. The last time a brother told me something else about the Munafiqeen. He said maybe they are brave enough to display their kufr, but because they want to work against the Muslim Ummah, they want to act as the fifth column, so they are hiding their iman in order to cause fasad. And which is true. So this, or the previous reason that we have mentioned, both reasons confirm what Allah Jalla wa Ala said about them, that they are what? إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَرِ مِنَ النَّارِ, in the lowest part of the fire of hell. So they take their iman, their oaths, in order to conceal or cover their reality, which is the reality of kufr. Allah Jalla wa Ala said, what a bad deed, or what an evil thing that they used to do. Then Allah Jalla wa Ala said, this happened to them because they believed, then they disbelieved. After seeing the light, they preferred the darkness rather than the light, which means that they are really evil. And because of this, their hearts were concealed, so they will not understand anything and they will not see the reality. And those munafiqun, among their qualities, their bodies are okay, their tongue is okay. In fact, you might be pleased when you see their bodies, when you hear their kalam, their speech. وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَهُمْ تُعْجِبُكَ أَجْسَامُهُمْ وَيَقُولُوا تَسْمَعْ لِقَوْلِهِمْ. Either كَأَنَّهُمْ خُشُبٌ مُسَنَّدَةٌ, as if they are blocks of wood put off yeah, as a matter of condemnation or as a matter of praise that they have solid figures, whether this or that, they are really munafiqun. Don't be pleased or don't be deceived but the way they look. In fact, the way they look, the way they look does not reflect the real reality, their real evil reality, their real foolish reality, empty reality. And in fact, they are so empty and they know that they are liars and they are pretending something they don't have, and their bodies represent nothing except cowardness and except disbelief, to the level that whenever someone calls anything, they think that, oh, they are being exposed or he is calling them. That's why Allah Jalla Ala said, be careful of them. Be careful of them. They are the real enemies. Be careful of them. قَاتَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ May Allah curse them. And among their qualities, that if they had a chance, which is the best chance they can have in the dunya, which is وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا يَسْتَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ Yes, come. Go to the Prophet. Let him ask forgiveness for you. This is a great opportunity for them if they are really sincere. No, they will refuse this request. Out of what? Out of arrogance. لَوَّ رُؤُسَهُمْ وَرَعَيْتَهُمْ يَصُدُّونَ وَهُمْ مُسْتَكْبِرُونَ They turn away saying that we are not interested. Subhanallah. Interested in what? Interested in seeking the forgiveness of Allah Jalla Ala, or even interested in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asking forgiveness for you. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. This shows the level of disbelief and the level of kufr they have. And Allah Jalla Ala said, because of their arrogance, Allah Jalla Ala said, see, whether you seek forgiveness for them or you don't seek forgiveness for them, Allah will never forgive them. Why? Allah لا يهدي القوم الفاسقين, because they will not be guided. How they will not be guided? It doesn't mean that Allah will never guide them. No. Allah Jalla Ala said, they will not be guided, because he knew that they will never be guided, and hence Allah Jalla Wa'ala will never forgive them. And again, among their qualities is they think that they, the munafiqun, the hypocrites, they deal with the dunya. Materialistic life is the standard for them. That's why they think that everyone is in need of them. They think that if they own wealth, if they own money, and if they have some other means of strength, power, maybe dignity, position in dunya, they think that they got everything. And because this is their corrupted standard, they think that everyone in the world has that corrupted standard. So they think that, they will say to the poor Muslims, listen, we will never give sadaqah to you. Yeah, we will never help you. They think that once they say this to the Muslims will really feel low because of this. They will feel devastated, and they might even beg them. They might ask the munafiqeen. They say, هم الذين يقولون, Allah Jalla Ala described them by saying, هُمُ الَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ لَا تُنْفِقُوا عَلَى مَنْ عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ Don't spend on those immigrants, those humble people. And if you don't spend on them, maybe they will turn to us. Maybe they will leave the Prophet. Leave him alone. Because they are judging everyone according to their own standard. وَلِلَّهِ خَزَائِنُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ They don't know that Allah Jalla Ala owns the treasures of heavens and earth, and Allah Jalla Ala will give anyone whatever he wants, as Allah Jalla Ala has given them to test them. Allah Jalla Ala can give others, so they should not feel arrogant because they have this amount of wealth. And they should not think of everyone around them as if they think of themselves, that wealth is everything in this life. This is, as we said, like some munafiqeen in our community, they always ask people, they always ask people to work for some of the intelligence services here or to spy on Muslims, and they promise them that we will give you this and the government will do this for you, will help you this and that and this and that. They think that all Muslims, yeah, are beggars like them. Yes, they think that all Muslims have low ethical or low iman like them, that they are after just position or after materialistic affairs or after something like this. No, they don't think that Muslims have higher standards. Real Muslims have higher standards, higher aims. That's why these things will deceive only low people who lost their values. They lost their iman. But others are not like this. So, this is, subhanAllah, the standard with munafiqeen all of the time. And subhanAllah, if you look at those who act as the fifth column in any community, in any society, you will see that they are acting as fifth column, either because of a level of hatred they have against the society, or normally because of something materialistic, something very, very cheap. SubhanAllah. And not only that, once wealth captured their hearts, they think that once wealth captured their hearts, they start acting like dogs. Even in fact, dogs might be more dignified than those people once they become the worshippers of dirham and dinar. That's why they also, out of their arrogance, يَقُولُونَ لَأَنْ رَجَعْنَا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ. And we said that this incident or this ayah might refer to the incident of Ghazwat al-Muraysiyah, when the conflict took place between the Ansar and the Muhajirun, and then the hypocrites, whether the hypocrites in general or Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, he said, yeah, now they feel empowered, those Muslims, those immigrants. He said, when we go back to Medina, they will see what we will do with those humble, humiliated people. Well, they will see who will expel the other from the Medina, and we will expel, kick them out all. Yes, because dignity and might belong to us. And Allah Jalla Ala said, in reality, and we have commented on this ayah a lot last time, we said this is a principle that we need to remember all the time. وَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةُ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Yes. Power, might, dignity belong to who? To Allah Azza wa Jal. And as we said last time, so for not anyone to say that, yeah, it belongs to Allah and His Prophet, but we as Muslims should not feel this. Okay, no. Allah Jalla wa Ala said, Izzah, glory, power, dignity, might belong to Allah, His Messenger, and the believers. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Ali Imran, وَلَا تَهِنُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا what? وَأَنْتُمُ الْأَعْلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. Yes, don't be sad, don't grieve. Why? Because you are superior as far as you are believers. And we said, my dear respected brothers and sisters, that this principle has to be established in our life. Yeah, has to be established in our life. Never ever feel inferior under any circumstance. Allah Jalla wa Ala does not accept us to feel inferior while we are holding His religion. Yes, Allah Jalla wa Ala does not like this at all. Okay, in fact, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لا ينبغي لمسلم أن يذل نفسه. It's not allowed for a Muslim to belittle himself or to disgrace himself. Yes, and Allah Jalla wa Ala also says in the Quran when he described the believers what? أذلة على المؤمنين أعزة على الكافرين. أذلة in front of مؤمن. Humbles of in front of mu'mins, but in front of disbelievers, what is it? Yes, harsh is not a good translation. No, izza is not harsh. Izza is to feel dignified, to feel glorified. Yes, to feel empowered, to feel confident. This is izza, to feel your dignity. Yes, you are a dignified person. In front of everyone, okay, and in particular in front of disbelievers, not because of arrogance, but because you don't want the deen of Allah Jalla wa Ala to be disgraced or to be looked down upon. Okay, so this is a very important principle. We said that Allah Jalla wa Ala concluded by the munafiqeen, they don't know this reality, this important principle. Then Allah Jalla wa Ala said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, لا تلهكم أموالكم ولا أولادكم عن ذكر الله. After talking about the منافقين and describing their qualities, Allah Jalla wa Ala spoke about the believers. Subhanallah, my dear brothers and sisters, you rarely find a surah that talking about negative things, negative things, negative things. Of course, what do we mean by negative things? يعني مثلا the kuffar and the disbelievers. Okay? Without giving hope to what? To the believers. Or without talking about believers in general that, well, there are the negative things, but there are the positive things. There are the evil people, but also there are the good people, and the door or the doors are open for you to be good people. Okay, you rarely find surah talking about just the qualities of the disbelievers. Okay, so Allah Jalla wa Ala started here to speak about the qualities of the disbelievers. The qualities of believers and what Allah Jalla wa Ala commands them to do. In a way, Allah Jalla wa Ala is saying, Ya munafiqin, if you want to come out of nifaq, do this. The door is open for you. If you really want to be out of nifaq, do this. And Allah Jalla wa Ala wants to say also that if people feel that they are or fear nifaq for themselves, this is the way to make sure that they can protect themselves from nifaq. So Allah Jalla wa Ala here commanded believers to give sadaqah. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُلْهِكُمْ أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَلَا أَوْلَادُكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. Sorry, the main topics of those two ayat, or three ayat, is one, that you should not be busy with the children's and wealth and properties, and because you became so busy with wealth and properties, you became diverted from the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is one thing. And the other one is what? The issue of, or the importance of sadaqah. Now, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, لا تلهكم أموالكم ولا أولادكم عن ذكر الله. Let not your properties or your children divert you from the remembrance of Allah. The meaning, the general meaning is clear. The general meaning is clear. Now, Allah Jalla wa Ala, here said we should not be diverted by those things, although they are halal. diverted from remembering what Allah Jalla wa'ala. Which means Allah Jalla wa'ala wants to say that His remembrance is the most important thing in this life. Yes? Because nothing, your properties, your children should not divert you from remembering Allah Jalla wa'ala. Which means that the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa'ala is the highest. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الدُّنْيَا مَلْعُونَ مَلْعُونٌ مَا فِيهَا إِلَّا ذِكْرُ اللَّهُ وَمَا وَلَى. Yeah? The dunya is mal'una, cursed. And everything in the dunya is cursed except what? Except the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Which means that, my dear respected brothers and sisters, the whole purpose of this dunya, the whole purpose of this hayah is what? To make dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. If anyone would say that there is another purpose of this dunya other than remembering Allah Jalla wa'ala, then this person is deceived and he is deceiving others. He did not understand the reality of this dunya. Okay? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that dunya mal'una, mal'una ma fiha illa dhikrullah wa ma wala. This is the reality of the dunya. And we all know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if a dunya is equal to a wing of a mosquito, in the sight of Allah jalla wa ala, Allah jalla wa ala wouldn't give from it what? To a disbeliever, a sip of water. Means that Allah jalla wa ala considers this dunya as worth nothing, nothing at all. Nothing at all. You should not be busy with it. You should not even think about it at all. This is the value of the dunya. And that's why the role model for us, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he never been busy with any matter related to the dunya. Not at all. He never thought of it at all. And when he died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's had a debt. And you know the hadith that we mentioned when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to talk to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about divorcing his wives. He said, I looked at his house. Yes, mashallah. What is in the house of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, Wallahi ma ra'aytu shay'an yaruddu al-'ayna. I have never seen something that I can be pleased with. The only thing in one narration, he said the only thing that he found is a shield, yes, a bow, and a skin. This is the bed of the Prophet ﷺ. And when he moved from his sleep, I found the marks of the wooden bed or the wooden maybe plate he was sleeping on, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha taqul, she is saying that, by Allah, yes, we remain for 1 month or 2 months, 2 months. Leave 2 months, 1 month, and we do not cook anything. Then Masruq told her, Ya Umm al-Mu'mineen, so what was your food? You don't cook anything? Ma yuqadu fi bayti Rasulillahi shay'. You don't cook anything? So what was your food? She said, Al-Aswadan, Al-Tamru, Wal-Ma'. Subhanallah. And one time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أعظم الخلق, أفضل الخلق, نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم, the best of humanity, ما وطئت هذه الأرض قدمان أفضل من قدم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. One time he goes out of his house. Yes, he meets Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. And he said, Abu Bakr, why are you coming at this moment of time? He said, Ya Rasulullah, very hungry, very hungry. Subhanallah. This Abu Bakr, the strong man, he said, I came because I'm too hungry, I haven't eaten. Then the Prophet ﷺ would uncover his clothes and he would be seen what? That he tightened what? A stone on his stick in his stomach so he doesn't feel the pain of hunger. Sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And then he says to him, Wallahi ma akhrajani illa alladhi akhrajak. I have never left except after the pain of hunger. Imagine, to this level, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And he could have at least, as we say, live just a simple life. No, not even a simple life. Life like poor people. life like poor people, not just a simple life. A simple life means he eats maybe one meal a day, or one meal maybe 2 days or 3 days, but not a meal, a single meal for a month. This is too much. This is too much. This is the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam, and this is the life of his companions. Yet, despite all of this, they opened. They managed to what? To open most of the Middle East at that time, or most of the peninsula. And the Muslim army attacked the borders of the Roman Empire at that time, the Persian Empire at that time, and they have taken most of the Yemen at that time with this poor, devastated situation, subhanAllah, because the real power doesn't lie in wealth. The real power lies in the Iman of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Anyway, so Allah Jalla wa'ala said, don't be deceived by this dunya. Don't be deceived by this dunya. Don't be busy by your wealth and your properties. Your properties and your children. And here the ayah also confirms something else. That any minute we spend away from dhikr Allah Jalla ala will be what? Will be regretting it on the day of resurrection. Because Allah Jalla ala said, don't be deceived by your children. Yes, by your wealth. Don't spend time with them that they what? They divert you from the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And that's why in the hadith Ma'ad, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا يَتَحَسَّرْ أَهْلُ الْجَنَّةِ تَحَسُّرَهُمْ عَلَى سَاعَةٍ لَمْ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى فِيهَا. They don't regret, as they regret any single minute in which they did not make dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Now, my dear brothers, my dear sisters, Allah Jalla wa Ala said, don't let your properties and your children to divert you from the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Definitely, when I sleep, what? I don't remember Allah Jalla wa Ala. So am I going to regret my sleep? When I eat, I don't remember Allah Jalla wa Ala. When I have sexual relationship with my wife, I don't remember Allah Jalla wa Ala. When I maybe go to work, I don't remember Allah Jalla wa Ala. I am busy with other things. No. This is not the meaning. Allah Jalla wa Ala wants all of our life. Listen to this important explanation. Allah Jalla wa Ala wants all of our life to be for Him because of Him. Yes? To be for Him because of Him. Okay? And that's why Allah Jalla wa Ala says, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. My salah, my sacrifice, my life, my death, all of it for Allah. How come? How it can be? Yes. When the person does anything because of Allah, then that actual thing that he is involved in or she is involved in becomes what? Becomes dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And this is the beauty of Islam. So when the person eats, but he eats, first of all, remembering that this is a ni'mah that Allah Jalla wa Ala has given him, and this person also eats, observing the boundaries of Allah Jalla wa Ala, so he doesn't go against the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala, and this person eats thinking that he will get a certain benefit from this food. For example, a person wants to fast tomorrow. He knows that he cannot fast tomorrow until he eats what? A good meal. Although he is eating and not making dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala, but the purpose of the meal is what? Is dhikr of Allah, so it becomes what? Itself a dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala. When the person, he needs to go for work because he needs a job. Because why he needs a job? Because he needs to get married in order to preserve his chastity. And he needs to give sadaqah. So the minute he is going to job in order to earn money, in order to preserve his chastity, not because of luxury, not because he has to do it, he doesn't know what is the purpose of it, or people are doing it, Once the person does it like this, it means that he is doing it because of dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala, and that's why it considers to be what? A dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Is it clear? When the person goes to bed and he knows that he wants to go to bed in order to wake up early in the morning, in order for him, first of all, to wake up for Fajr, and then he needs to have a rest in order to go to work. Why does he work? Ask yourself, my dear brothers, my dear sisters, why are you working? Because I have to earn money, otherwise I will beg people. And Allah Jalla wa'ala doesn't want us to humiliate ourselves in front of anyone. Allah Jalla wa'ala wants us to live in dignity. And I might earn some money, I might give sadaqah. So now the amount of time you spend for work is what? Is because of the dhikr. So it is dhikr. So it has not diverted you from the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa'ala. This is the meaning of it. And that's why, my dear respected brothers and sisters, in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith of Ad-Darda, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى خَيْرِ أَعْمَالِكُمْ أَزْكَاهَا عَنْدَ نِرِيكِكُمْ خَيْرٍ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنْ تَلْقَوْا عَدُوَكُمْ فَتَضْرِبُوا عَنَاقُمْ وَيَضْرِبُوا عَنَاقَكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَى يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَالَ ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ. Shall I tell you about the best of your deeds, the best than jihad, the best than giving sadaqah, fi sabilillah, the best, better than meeting your enemies, you kill them, they kill you. They said, Ya Rasulullah, what is that? What is that? Which is better than jihad, better than sadaqah fi sabilillah, better than all of these things. What is it? What is it? Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the remembrance of Allah. Ibn Hajar said, how come remembrance of Allah is better than jihad? How come? He said, yes, this remembrance of Allah Jalla wa'ala is remembering Allah Jalla wa'ala by your heart. So when Allah Jalla wa'ala is placed in your heart, not just on the tongue, is placed on your heart, then your actions, all of your actions, your limbs will enact what is in your heart, will act according to what is in your heart. So therefore, all of your external actions will what? Will reflect the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. So when you eat because of the dhikr. When you sleep because of the dhikr. When you have sexual relationship with your wife, you do it because of the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala, subhanallah. Even, and that's why the companions said, Ya Rasulullah, we enjoy ourselves, have sex with our wives, and it is considered to be ajr. He said, yes, because you are doing it what? To stop yourself from haram. So, when they did it, in their minds is what? In their minds is Allah. This is the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala, my dear respected brothers and sisters. This is the real meaning of the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And hence, subhanallah, once the person places Allah Jalla wa'ala in his heart, in his mind, or let us put it this way, once Allah Jalla wa'ala accepted to be placed in the heart and the mind of the person, Allah Jalla wa'ala will place his remembrance on his tongue. And this is the real meaning of the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And you rarely find a person who remembers Allah Jalla wa'ala a lot by his tongue and his heart is diverted away from the real dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala, from the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. I hope that this meaning is clear. That's why those who want to force themselves to remember Allah Jalla wa'ala all of the time, they are trying their best, inshallah, to make dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. And if they are doing it like maybe together and they are chanting by dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala, means that they are suffering from a problem, that they are unable to remember Allah Jalla wa'ala by their actions, so they want to force it on their tongues. And moreover, then when the person feels that, oh, he is doing this dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala by the tongue, then he might feel that there is no need for him to make dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala by what? By heart and by action. And this is the most important dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Okay, so this is the ayah, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. Okay, the ayah also started by Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la tulhikum amwalukum. It did not start by awladukum. Why? Because the ability of the wealth to divert the person from the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala is more than the ability of what? Of the children. Yes, and this is known. Also, they said that this ayah, Allah Jalla Ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُلْهِكُمْ أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ or وَلَا أَوْلَادُكُمْ. No, وَلَا أَوْلَادُكُمْ, because each one has its power to divert people from the remembrance of Allah Jalla Ala. Okay, here, لا تلهكم أموالكم ولا أولادكم عن ذكر الله, not عن تذكر الله. Remembrance might be translated as ذكر and remember and تذكر. تذكر, you remember Allah جل وعلا. تذكر, تذكر, you remember him. Not ذكر. ذكر is more than just تذكر, because تذكر means you might remember Allah جل وعلا in your heart. Okay, but you don't do actual dhikr of him by your actions, by your limbs, and by your tongue. And as we said, that you rarely find a person who makes dhikr of Allah Jalla Ala by his tongue, and he has no dhikr of Allah Jalla Ala by his heart. Okay, so this is the meaning of dhikr. I want all of the brothers and sisters to be aware of this, and that's why we said that. When the person understands the real dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala, you will see that this person is active in all fields of life. You don't see this person just sitting in the masjid doing the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala, let America occupy the lands of Muslims, let Britain stop Muslims from teaching Quran in the masajid. And he said, we don't need to worry about this. We it is not our business. If we fix ourselves, everything will be fixed around us. No. No, Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to struggle. Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to defend his religion. Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to be active. Allah Jalla wa Ala wants us to move, to change the whole society around us in order to make the whole society worshipping Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is the real meaning of the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And as I always say, anyway, we'll conclude, even a person who is busy in politics, because of Allah, then his involvement in politics is dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala, if the motivation was a sincere motivation and he is observing the guidelines of Sharia as well. And then Allah Jalla wa Ala said, وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. The one who does this, what? The one who is letting the properties, the wealth, diverting him from the remembrance of Allah Jalla wa Ala, they are really what? Losers. They are losers. No, Allah Jalla wa Ala said they are the losers. The losers. Which means that there is no loss beyond this loss. And definitely there is no loss beyond this loss. As we have explained it, alhamdulillah, clearly. Just because of time, Allah Jalla wa Ala said then the second thing, وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. Spend. Spend as a sadaqah, as a charity, as any type of charity, of that which we have provided for you before death comes to you. Give sadaqah, give a charity before what? Before death comes to one of you. When death comes to one of you, what will one of you say? Oh Allah, فَيَقُولَ رَبِّ لَوْلَا أَخَّرْتَنِي إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ قَرِيبٍ. Oh Allah, please. لَوْلَا here means please, as if he's begging Allah Jalla wa Ala. Is a word of encouragement. لَوْلَا هَلَّا. Okay, of course, it is not a command because the person cannot command this. And it is not a strong request because he knows that خلاص, it is over now. So he said, رَبِّ لَوْلَا, لَوْلَا, please. Please, just give me a chance. And this is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, تَصَدَّقُوا, تَصَدَّقُوا. Or he said, in the other hadith, أَفْضَلُ الصَّدَقَةِ, the best of sadaqah, when a person of you is giving sadaqah, when he is what? When he is wealthy, and he is what? He is aiming to live more, subhanallah. And he is what? Too tight, he's too worried about what? About his wealth. Yes? This is afdal sadaqah. So you think that you are going to live for long life. And you are what? You are wealthy and you are tight. You have the money and you are tight on the money. This is afdal sadaqah. And not afdal sadaqah that you leave it. Yes? You don't give sadaqah while you are healthy. And then when on the deathbed, khalas, Now you know that there is no hope for you. The money is going to be taken by your children or by your family or by other people. Then you remember and then you'll say, oh, give so-and-so this, give so-and-so this, go so-and-so this. That's why you young people, yes? Wallahi, you're a chance for earning a lot of ajr, more than the chance of the elders. Because the elders, khalas, I'm not yani criticizing the elders, but I'm encouraging the young people. The elders, khalas, they are retired, they have nothing to do, they can spend the whole day in the masjid. They don't like to use social network, they don't like to spend their time on watching TV, so they can read Quran, they can give sadaqah. But for you young people, yes, £1 means a lot for you. To spend some time to read Quran means a lot of you. That's why the best deeds are the deeds of who? Of not the elders. The best deeds are the deeds of who? Of the young people. That's why Allah Jalla wa'ala, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سَبْعَةٌ يُظِلُّهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظِلِّ يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلُّ, most of them are what? Young people. Most of them are as what? وَشَابٌ مُعَلَّقٌ قَلْبُهُ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ and وَرَجُلٌ دَعَتْهُ امْرَأَةٌ ذَاتُ مَنْصِبٍ وَجَمَالٍ فَقَالَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ وَرَجُلَانِ تَحَابَّا فِي اللَّهِ. If you explain them, most of them are young people. Yes? Same thing, the sadaqah of the young people. Of course, it doesn't mean that the sadaqah of the old people is not worth it. No, it's worth it. In fact, this ayah is saying that, okay, that the sadaqah might be the last resort for you. The last resort for you. And it is ajeeb, my dear brothers and sisters, that Allah Jalla wa'ala, mentioned the sadaqah in a way as if he is saying that it is the last resort for the human being. It is the last chance for the human being. You know, in Hadith Adi ibn Hatim, two men came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of them was complaining about poverty, and the other one was complaining about what? About theft. Yes, road theft. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, anyway, in a long hadith, he said, in terms of poverty, don't worry about poverty. Allah Jalla wa'ala will give people money. Until people will take the money and they want to give sadaqah, zakah to anyone, and they don't find anyone to accept the sadaqah. That's why the Prophet ﷺ in the other hadith said, give sadaqah before you want to give sadaqah and no one is willing to accept the sadaqah from you. So the Prophet ﷺ said, don't worry about poverty. You will, a time will come, you want to take your sadaqah to give it to people, and you don't find people to give them sadaqah. So then the Prophet ﷺ, fear a day. When you come before Allah Jalla wa'ala, listen to this, my dear brothers and sisters. And please, those who are sinners, those who think that they are evil, those who think that they have no hope, yes, please listen to this, because see, you have no excuse to say that I have no hope to be a good person or forget about good person. You have no excuse not to protect yourself from the fire of hell. Yes, you have no excuse at all. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in this hadith, when the person comes to in front of Allah Jalla wa'ala, he will look on the right, he will see nothing but the fire of hell. He will look on the left, he will see nothing but the fire of hell. And he will look in front of him, he will see nothing but the fire of hell. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, which means that this person has no hope. So he said, فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ وَلَوْ بِشِقِّ تَمْرَةٍ. Protect yourself from the fire of hell, even by giving just a piece of date as a sadaqah. And this is my appeal to all of you, my dear brothers and sisters. Allah Jalla wa'ala wants us, Allah Jalla wa'ala does not want us to go to hellfire. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not want us to go to hellfire under any circumstance. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, do something, even if it is small, even by giving one piece of date as a sadaqah. So my appeal to you, my dear brothers and sisters, whenever you have a chance to give even one pea as a sadaqah, don't delay it. Yes? And my appeal to you, every day, just take an amount of money, even if it is 50p, 50p, والله it will not make you rich, it will not make you poor. Put it aside and give it as a sadaqah. Yes, and subhanallah, if you read the ayat and the hadith about the sadaqah, as if Allah Jalla wa Ala said that I left sadaqah for you as the last resort for you to protect yourself from the fire of hell. So فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ وَلَوْ بِشِقِّ تَمْرَى. This is one hadith. Also this hadith that the person, when he sees the death, he will say, Ya Allah, Ya Allah, just delay me. For what? فَأَصَّدَّقَ. So the first thing he will think of is what? Is giving sadaqah. Because of the what? The impact of sadaqah in protecting the person from the fire of hell. And that's why in the other hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, As-sadaqatu tutfi'u ghadab al-Rabb. As-sadaqah extinguishes the anger of Allah jalla wa ala. And we know, we all know, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, دخلت امرأة بغي من بني إسرائيل الجنة. She entered the Jannah although she was a prostitute. And this is a message to everyone, even if she is a prostitute, even you brothers, even if you think that you are the most evil person in the world, just give something to protect yourself from the fire of hell. And Allah Jalla wa Ala is so merciful. Allah Jalla wa Ala might forgive you because of £1 you have given it to a devastated person, or maybe a piece of bread you have given it to a hungry person. So just give sadaqah. Just give sadaqah. That's why that prostitute gave sadaqah to what? To the dog. And Allah Jalla wa Ala forgave her sins, forgave her zina, which is the most evil, or one of the most evil acts. Allah Jalla wa Ala forgave her zina because of what? Because of a sadaqah to a dog, not even a sadaqah to a human being. So how about a sadaqah that is given to what? A human being. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam said, الصدقة والقرآن. The sadaqah and the Quran. So decide for the person on the day of resurrection. So give sadaqah, my dear brothers and sisters, and don't worry about poverty. Don't worry about that Allah Jalla wa Ala will decrease your wealth. In fact, Allah Jalla wa Ala said in the Quran, الشيطان يعدكم الفقر. الشيطان is promising you what? Poverty. والله يعدكم مغفرة منه وفضلا. And Allah Jalla wa Ala is promising you, subhanallah, two things. Yes? الشيطان يعدكم الفقر. Who is promising you فقر, poverty? The shaytan. And who is promising us مغفرة, forgiveness and increase? It's Allah Jalla wa Ala. Some scholars said مغفرة is the reward of the akhirah, and fadla is the reward of the dunya, that Allah Jalla wa Ala will give the person increase in the dunya. Increase in the dunya. Some other scholars said al-maghfira, reward in the dunya and reward in the akhirah. And the fadl is a reward in the dunya as well as a reward in the akhirah. Also Allah Jalla wa Ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِ. Allah Jalla wa Ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ, أَنْفِقُوا مِنْ طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. In Surah, the ayah before Ayat al-Kursi. يا أيها الذين آمنوا أنفقوا مما رزقناكم من قبل أن يأتي يوم لا بيع فيه ولا خلة ولا شفاعة. سبحان الله. Again, as we said that the sadaqah is the last resort for the person, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا, before أنفقوا, before a day comes that there is no sadaqah, there is no friendship, there is no khulla, there is nothing that helps you except your deeds. So my appeal to you, my dear brothers and sisters, to give sadaqah as much as you can. one of the Salaf, he used to give sadaqah on a daily basis. One time, they found him carrying an onion. Then one of his friends, he said, Ya Aba Habib, yeah, his name is Abu Habib Marthad. He said, why are you carrying an onion? It will spoil the smell of your clothes. He said, I was looking for something to give as a sadaqah in my house. And I did not find anything in my house to give as a sadaqah except this onion. I took it and I said I might give it to a poor person, he might use it. Wallahi, I will give sadaqah every day after I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, after I heard one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Uqba ibn Amir, saying that the person will be shielded by his sadaqah on the day of resurrection. So my dear respected brothers and sisters, I appeal to all of you to give sadaqah as much as you can. We were planning to finish the dars today, but anyway, alhamdulillah, we'll try to finish it inshallah next week, and inshallah we will also start with the new surah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.